Hi guys! Today's video is going to be a Draw My Life Hamster Edition Part 2 video. And if you haven't watched Part 1 yet, you can go watch it if you'd like to hear about my very first hamster and where I started out on this whole journey. In this video, I have a lot of ground to cover and a lot of hamsters to talk about, so I'm going to just dive right in and I hope you enjoy this. After my first hamster, S'mores, passed away, you guys might remember how upset I was about it and how I never thought that I would get another hamster. So all of S'mores' supplies were given away in a yard sale, and that was the end of it until about a few years later. I don't even recall what happened to make me suddenly want a hamster again, but I went to a local pet shop and I fell in love with a tiny, long-haired male Syrian hamster. I picked up a new 10-gallon tank. I got a wire wheel and some other basic supplies. I named the hamster Tin Roof Sundae, which was a type of ice cream flavor, and he had a very calm and laid-back personality. He was a wonderful hamster to get me back into owning hamsters again, and he let me hold him and he never bit. He lived for about 3.5 years and passed from old age, which again, I found difficult to cope with, so I got rid of the aquarium and supplies, and that was the end of it for another few years. Well, a few more years later, I got bit by the hamster bug again, but this time it was like two obsessive levels. I didn't just want a hamster, I needed a hamster. I did have a dachshund at this time who was a wonderful companion, but I wanted another pet to love and care for. Since it had been quite a few years already and I was older by this point, I decided it would be smart to start spending time doing research before getting a hamster again. Quite a bit had changed with care, as I quickly realized when browsing online. I joined a hamster forum in 2007 called Hamster Hideout Forum. And this is a place that I owe all of my learning and knowledge to. By this time, I just couldn't wait any longer to have a hamster again. I had saved money up, and I went out to buy a 20-gallon long aquarium, which was 360 square inches, and I got the tank home and got it all set up, and much to my surprise and disappointment, I had placed minimal supplies in the tank and already was thinking to myself, there's hardly any room left in here for the hamster to move around. I'm a little bit disappointed. I was slightly worried, but not overly so, since everyone had recommended this tank as a good size. I finished preparing it and I went out another evening to go look at hamsters at Petco. I stayed in Petco for probably at least an hour, just observing the different hamsters they had and how they behaved. One hamster in particular caught my eye and had me giggling with her antics. She was a cream dominant spot hamster, and I thought she was the prettiest and cutest thing ever. I decided she was the one for me, so I nervously asked the employee to help me get her out. I remember how friendly and social this hamster was, climbing up the employee's shirt and nibbling on her name badge. I was trying to remain composed on the outside, but inside I was a puddle of squee and completely enamored by hamsters once again. This hamster, Cream Puff, taught me so much about hamsters and their needs, especially when it comes to female Syrian hamsters. She was extremely active and hyper all the time, so I decided soon after that she needed more space. I went out and I bought some Habitrail Ovo supplies to hook up to her tank, remembering the fun that my first hamster had had with all of his tubes. And I assumed this would fix the issue of her behavior, but unfortunately it only made it worse. And I went out and I bought more pods and more tubes trying to make her happy. I even added on another 10-gallon tank, but the more space that I added, the more energetic and hyper that Cream Puff became. She was chewing like crazy all the time. I did not realize that she needed one larger space to run and much deeper bedding to dig in, but I was trying my best to make her happy with the knowledge that I had. I finally went out and I bought another 20 long tank because that was all that I had left for space at the time. And now she had two 20 long aquariums, multiple ovopods and tubes, and a 10 gallon tank. It became a bit of a joke with my family on how needy and demanding that cream puff was, but this is actually a very common behavior for Syrians. I just wasn't yet aware of their needs. Cream puff lived for close to 2 years, and she left a huge imprint on my heart because she had such a big personality and she taught me so much, even though there was still new knowledge that I had yet to learn. During the time that I owned Cream Puff, I became aware of the option to adopt hamsters, and I learned of sites like Pet Finder, so I wanted to add another furry to my family, and I came across an ad for a dwarf hamster, which I had never owned a dwarf hamster before, so I was pretty excited. This gal was a black and white mottled Russian Campbell. She was a special needs hamster as she was blind, deaf, and partially paralyzed. I still don't know how she became that way, but her ad absolutely tugged at my heartstrings. I adopted Cookies and Cream, and we formed a very special bond. It was my first intro into adoption, and let me tell you, I was completely hooked. The feeling of giving an unwanted animal a second chance at life was the most rewarding feeling ever. I went on to adopt more hamsters during this time. There was whipped cream, cream brulee, Bavarian cream. I also adopted a male long-haired Syrian named Teddy Graham, and he reminded me very much of my past hamster, Tin Roof Sunday. By this point, I had become passionate about adoption, and I decided to take the leap into fostering hamsters. I fostered two Syrians for quite a few months until they were able to find good homes. After sending them off and saying farewell, I realized that fostering was too difficult for me emotionally, and it was something I would never do again. I certainly have the utmost respect for anyone who fosters and rescues animals as a full-time thing because it is a lot of work time and money, and also it's an emotional investment. After this, I became hamsterless once more, but I had the desire to build a larger cage for my future hamster. I began researching DIY cages and was largely inspired by the wooden cages that German hamster owners build. They were large and spacious in all of the photos I was seeing, so I set out to make one similar to it, and I built my first DIY cage that was 1,247 square inches, and I was then ready, over 4 months later, to adopt a hamster again. A Chinese hamster's ad popped up, and this was a species that I had never owned before. He was named Wonton, and Wonton appears in my very first YouTube video ever that I posted called Wonton's Wonderland. Not only did he have the DIY cage, but he also had multiple modular cages that were connected with a huge tunnel system. It was pretty amazing, and he loved scurrying back and forth between all of the different cages. After Wonton passed away, I continued adopting hamsters, upgrading my cage setups, and I began posting videos regularly on YouTube. You guys might remember Baklava, Yodel, Strudel, Gingersnap, Sumatra, Pudding, Dumpling, and Carob. There was a huge amount of learning that I did during this time period, and I continued making mistakes. Once Carob had passed away, I recalled her day-to-day behavior, and I came to realize that even a 1,200 square inch cage was still not large enough for most Syrians. So this was when I decided to upgrade my old DIY cage and to build my new one that is 3,780 square inches. This is the absolute largest size that I could build and fit in my room. It was certainly a lot of work and money, but worth every single penny now that I look back on it. Once that cage was built, it was around 6 months later when I found and adopted my 20th hamster, KASHI, and she has been my first hamster ever to live in the giant hamster mansion. Owning hamsters all these years has taught me so many things. It's taught me patience, care towards animals. It's taught me that learning never ends and we should always strive for better and be ready to change our care as time progresses. Hamsters have also connected me with special friends who are still in my life to this day, and I can't imagine having never met them. Most importantly, hamsters have filled my heart with so much happiness and love. They're so tiny, but they leave the biggest paw prints on our heart.